us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their efforts. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. Lord is Lord of all, and bestows his riches upon all who call upon him. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. The word of the Lord.
I had the privilege 21 years ago to experience the desert as the desert should truly be experienced. I was working in Grootfontein in Namibia and then traveled from Grootfontein through to the Namib Desert, to the Brandberg, through the petrified forest and down to Hengti's Bay. The Brandberg is wonderful because it is literally a mountain that has been burnt. And there are ancient rock engravings dating back about 10,000 years in that area. So one can feel the ancient presence of the place. And just near the Brandberg is the petrified forest, where literally over the floor of the desert you see these tree stumps lying from ancient conifers. In fact, conifers that were 15 million years old. They had petrified, and the ground on top of them had been blown away by the desert winds. And you have this petrified forest just lying on the ground of the desert, with little Welwitschia plants growing between the stumps, the petrified stumps. by which he implants that themselves can live to be 2,000 years old. And from there you take the desert road, and there's no one to talk to. There's nobody at Rambat. There is nobody at the petrified forest. There might be one visitor every 3 weeks. Then you fill up the cart ice and head down to Henty's bar. It's across a flat rock desert. So there is no road, there is no tar, there is nothing except a whitewashed stone here, a whitewashed stone there, and 10 meters further, two more whitewashed stones. That's the road through the desert. And you carry on with this, and I drove for about 160 kilometers, stopped the car, and then walked into the desert until I couldn't see the car anymore. And there I experienced it. The surface of the desert is bright white with the sunlight. And in the distance it just mixes into the sky, which is also white hot. The sky isn't blue there, it is white. And your sense of up and down takes a bit of a turn. Unless a rare breeze blows across your sweaty head, and at least you know this is up, because that's where the wind is sometimes. Your sense of up and down is in turmoil. Your sense of near and far is because there's nothing really to focus on, except if you look down to your feet, and that's pretty boring anyway. And then there's the silence. In fact, it's not silence, it's just nothing. There is so much nothing that even the silence runs away from it. It is just nothing. And then this awesome sense dawns over you. I am about 200 kilometers away from any other living human being in any direction, maybe even 300. The sense of being absolute, utterly, unmistakably alone is such a shock that even the noise of your head stops. And there is nothing. At least you still hear the air conditioning. Nothing. You just melt away. There's nothing left of yourself, there's nothing left of your history, there's nothing left of your thoughts, your worries, your cares and anxieties. There is just this. And so when I visited Palestine and went into the Judean desert, much later, I was looking forward to a similar experience, because the Judean desert is the same sort of topography. An ash-white desert, just limestone surface. The horizon melts into the sky. One would have the same sense of nothingness there. The only problem is with the Judean desert in modern days is you've got all these pilgrims trying to find nothing with each other all over the place, with tourist buses and people selling trinkets and Jerusalem crosses and selling your holy water from the Jordan, don't drink it, it's poisonous, and all these things happening around you. But I would imagine that in Jesus' time, there was, just the same as in the Namib desert, nothing. And when we come on the first Sunday of Lent and contemplate these texts of Jesus' temptations, there is the temptation focus on the three that are described in the Gospel. All those spectacular to and fro's with the devil and flying up to mountains and all the rest. But in fact, what the Gospel authors, the evangelists, lead us to is that simple phrase, moved by the Spirit, he went into the desert and stayed there 40 days. I could hardly manage half an hour of the nothingness in the Namib. as I found the car pretty quickly and went down to end his buy and had a nice little lager on the beach, just to get over the shock. Imagine 40 days of it. Nothing. Nothing! Here you are, led by the Spirit. You've had this marvelous experience as Christ had at his baptism. The heavens open, the voice of God, the Holy Spirit. This wonderful upsurge within his own consciousness that there must have been. The connection between himself as fully human and fully divine. All that happening. And then there was the desert. And only on the 40th day does he have any company. And that happens to be the devil. For the other 39 days, there is to being before God, and for us to be before God in community, no matter how many middle-aged white men stand up here saying the same thing after the Gospel Sunday in and Sunday out. Just give ourselves to that. And God is working in us more profoundly than we can ever realize or than we can ever experience. And so the journey of Lent is simply an invitation, as we say in Afrikaans, to vasbyt, to knuckle down, to carry on being in God's presence, even when through boredom or distraction we remove ourselves from that presence. To simply be in that presence, even when it seems like nothing